This is the power steering pump off a Mini. Same one on the R50 and R53 too. Thanks, David, for giving me this one. Symptoms were power steering would intermittently disappear. So intermittent suggests it's got a problem, a common problem in here with the buildup of dust inside of here that the motor. I'm not going to go through how to get this out of the car several ways. They're all fairly difficult. And this, normally these connectors would be out, of course. Just wiggling back and forth to get each one of those off. And this one, from memory, is just a case of pulling hard to get it out. Okay, so how to get a housing off. Main trick with this one is the stators, the big magnets are built into the housing. So there's two ways this is going to come off. It's either going to shoot off of its own volition, or it's going to stay stuck on there, depending on which way the motor happens to have stopped when you had a go at this. Either way, there's a whole bunch of noxious dust. I have a full dust mask. This isn't something you want to walk around with, which seems to be the case here. Okay, so it's magnets, it's wanting to go back on. See all that dust in there? If it comes flying off, that dust is going to form a pretty nasty cloud. Worn through use and generating that dust gets into all the electronics, and that's what burns it out. So now I've blown all of that nasty purple dust out with a mask on. Things don't actually look too bad on this one. Right, so now it's apart. You can see the magnets. They're stuck to the side of the housing. So that can potentially be holding this motor in. You've also got this big bearing on the end, which sits in this housing at the end. We can remove these three Torx T27 from the other side. We need to get at the other side of the motor. And once you've got all three of those out, that will come off here. You may lose a bit of fluid here. Set that aside. This is what we need to take off next. There's a little circlip. This is one of those clips that is very likely to shoot off in the wrong direction or get bent as you're trying to remove it. So I could say be careful, but it's probably more appropriate to say good luck. Here we go, into the box, don't lose it. Having got the circlip out, the next step is to remove the motor. We're going to catch it when it hits the ground because it's a bit of a whack. Here we go, and rubber mallet. We don't want to damage this, but this is what we're hitting on. Okay, those two are finally separated, but this one took some pounding. Broke the seal just to keep the weather out. To be honest, it's probably better for this thing if it could breathe. And okay, and that clicks into that little retainer there. Just hold that and push it all the way. Taken these four screws out where the copper wire that's coming out and connecting to the brushes. So we need to separate that copper wire, which is welded to that post. Okay, so those four actually hold this together. So with that out of the way, okay, so what I'm going to do next is take the little Torx screws that hold this base plate in. No doubt there's some muck underneath it. So with the Torx T10, that's a little one, 1, 2, 3, 4 screws. Make note, because this is like a little bracket that'll come out. It's a few little brackets that'll come apart when you take this out, and you'll need to put them back in the same way. Give this one a bit more of a clean as well. I'm going to clean these up a little bit. Ideally you'd machine them. Okay, it's a sealed bearing, but you can put some new grease in a sealed bearing. So pry that little cover off nice and gently, doing as little damage as we can. You know what, that doesn't look too bad. I'm going to put that cover back on rather than risk putting a different type of grease in there that it doesn't like. Okay, we'll run some tests of some of the circuits in here. I'm not a electrical component expert, but I'll see if I can pick up any problems. So there's four big capacitors. And they're not puffy at all. They're not, you know, black and burnt out. So they've passed the first visual inspection. I'll put the multimeter on resistance and just take some measurements. See if they're all, I don't know what to expect, but see if they're all the same. That's probably a reasonable indicator. So what am I getting? 675 on that one. 676. 676. And 677. They seem pretty close to each other. In terms of resistance, I'll just check continuity. You know, there's a continuous circuit for these that connect through to the brushes. That's good. That's good. That one's all right. And we've got a closed circuit there as well. Okay, so there's a big diode in here, this one here, so I'll turn this multimeter, just a cheap one, but it's still got a diode test mode on there, and I'm not entirely sure, you go one on each, and I'm getting a reading of about 84 on that test mode. I swap them over, it just goes to one. So I think that's a sign of a good diode. 86, 84, swap them back, swap black, and I'm getting one. So I think that diode is okay. We've got some transistors over here. Try to avoid picking this up. picking this up by those. They're not structural. They will bend. All right, so there's another diode over here. What does that tell us? I get a number that way. And I get a number that starts low and goes to one the other way. So I'm not sure, that's probably a different type of diode. These transistors, let's see if I can get a reading. There's a number there. If I switch them, I get nothing. For some reason I can't get a reading off the... I can't get anything off connecting the other two poles. But they're both behaving the same way. So it's about the limit of my testing ability. Yeah, so that one's behaving the same way. These two right-hand ones are behaving like a diode at least. All right, otherwise I'm just checking over these connections. The main thing we're doing is just cleaning, right? There's some circuit board in there. I don't know what to do with that, except check it's clean. There's a circuit board here. Again, I'm just checking it's clean. I'm not about to start testing elements in there. And by all means, add a comment if you actually know what you're doing and can explain what people should look for. All right, I'm going to put a little bit of silicon grease around this O-ring. Now, for whatever reason, it's got stretched out. I managed to do this both times. Managed to get them both snapped while trying to remove this. And both of them were longer afterwards. See, it's overlapping here, so I'm just going to cut that to match. This one goes back on, so we're wanting to get these pins. They will connect through to the brushes, 1, 2, 3, 4. Connecting back onto here, so should only be one way this goes back on. Time to solder these connectors back on. Let's put a little bit of flux on here. That one I've physically got a good connection. This one, not so good. There we go, good close connection. One on the wire and one on the brush. And I'm getting zero. Check to make sure that this still keys in here properly. Because if, like me, you had to beat on this a bit, probably not in the same shape it was before. So let's just check that. Okay, so that's slotting in and I can hear it turning the pump. Next one to go together. These go onto here. Now the spins, of course, make sure you have all of your brushes pushed all the way home to these little clips. Use what you've got, something to knock this bearing down onto the shaft. You need to get this down far enough that the circlip around here. Okay, that's back on now. Now to get this driven all the way down, you're going to need something that is at least 12 millimeters round, and it will need to be have at least what's that about? I think it'd be at least 13 millimeters or half inch depth to it, okay, for it to be able to drive that all the way down. You drive it home till there's enough room for this clip, which I've already put in, goes into a little notch here. So if you don't get it all the way down, this clip won't hold. It'll just flail around, or worse still, flick off to the other side of the room. Next, release all of your brushes, all of that hammering to get this back in. It has actually popped them all out, so they're all in place. Otherwise it should just be a little bit of a push and it'll flick back in. Okay, you're dealing with a big magnet now, so you'll have limited control over how these go back together. Just make sure your O-ring is in place. And keep your fingers clear. Check that O-ring hasn't squirmed out. Next, putting these two pieces back together, there's really only one way. See, two of the screw holes are close together. This is the one you need to worry about in terms of getting it keyed in to the drive. Here we go, that's back on, and tighten those three screws up and you're ready to fit back into the car.